Good morning.
All right.
So you're all familiar with the multiple advantages of endovascular interventions. Clearly, you can do those with local anesthesia and some sedation. There's no incision involved. Oftentimes, these are done on an outpatient basis, at most overnight stay. So the recovery is pretty quick and well tolerated by the patient. The Achilles heel really relates to the durability of those interventions. The higher you are, the more durable they are. So the iliac intervention with angioplasty and stenting is clearly more durable than femoral popliteal intervention, and the least durable are infrapopliteal intervention. The closer you get to the foot, the less durable those interventions in terms of patency and outcomes are going to be. So when is it that you treat a patient with peripheral vascular disease? It really depends on the clinical indication. You've heard a very nice talk earlier about the non-invasive testing, but really what matters in terms of your decision to treat is the clinical presentation, not so much a number that you're going to get based on a CT or vascular lab. So for patients with claudication, you're typically going to intervene on them when they fail conservative measures and whenever they are severely disabled. It's not as forgiving for patients with critical limb ischemia where you have to intervene, otherwise you will end up with limb loss. And of course, for patients with acute limb ischemia, these are emergencies that you have to intervene upon if you think that the limb is salvageable. So for patients with claudication, at least in our practice, conservative management seems to be the first line. Depending really on how disabled the patient is, and this may include some medical therapy, but mainly exercise therapy. But oftentimes, patient cannot tolerate that, and then you move on to intervention. It is often enough for patient with claudication to treat proximal disease. If someone has multi-level disease and they claudicate, if you treat the iliac, that may be enough to relieve their symptoms. In general, you are going to use a balloon expandable stent in the very proximal iliac for orifice lesions, just because you can accurately position those, say, at the aortic bifurcation. In the remaining segments of the iliac, you can use either balloon expandable or self-expanding stents, and we can talk a little bit later about advantages and disadvantages. So once you improve the flow into the common femoral and profunda, as I mentioned, that may be enough to take the edge off and relieve the symptoms. If they have SFA or popliteal occlusion, you may not need to work on that if their symptoms are relieved. So their goal here is to resolve the symptoms, and you have to be careful not to convert them into critical limb ischemia. And rarely you have to perform, almost never, tibial interventions for someone who claudicates. In terms of tibial interventions, typically those are patients with critical limb ischemia. The interventions, the endovascular interventions, the mainstay include angioplasty with or without atherectomy. Stenting doesn't usually work in that distribution and is usually reserved for bailout if you can't keep it open. The durability, as you see from this diagram, is quite limited in terms of patency. So you may see yourself intervening repeatedly on those patients every few months if they continue to have CLI with recurrence. So what is it that you can use, at least in the United States, for below-the-knee intervention? It's usually angioplasty with or without debulking with atherectomy. Other modalities may not be available to us, such as drug-eluting technologies. We don't even know if these work or make a difference below the knee. I think the jury is still not out on those. And the limb outcomes with newer technologies, such as drug-eluting balloons and biovascular scaffolds, which are in trial, need to be demonstrated in clinical trials. So how do you plan a case? It starts, obviously, with the workup and the axis. Everyone, as you know, is going to get history and physical, and we typically would just do, in our practice, a Doppler and a duplex, and that will tell us what the level of disease is. So if you feel femoral pulses and they're good enough, then you know that your aortoiliac segments are open. From the Doppler exam, depending on your PVR tracings and the pressures, you know where the disease is, femoral popliteal or what have you, and then the duplex can clarify that. We don't routinely get CTA in our practice unless we can't feel a femoral pulse or we're suspecting aortoiliac occlusive disease. We would typically move, if we decide to treat the patient, we would just typically move to an angiogram based on the history and the clinical exam and the vascular lab testing. If you're doing infrapopliteal intervention, anti-grade access may be maybe preferred just because there are several advantages such as pushability, you avoid the hostile bifurcation, and you can oftentimes do the procedure with a 4 or 5 French sheath because all what you're using really is an angioplasty balloon. Having said that, a retrograde contralateral access from the other common femoral is most commonly used, at least by vascular surgeons. But when you do that, and if you're doing distal intervention, you really need full support of a long sheath that you end up parking up and over the bifurcation down into the popliteal. So this is typically a 90 centimeter sheath or so to give you as much support as possible. Brachial access can be utilized to do a distal intervention. You have to be aware of the length limitation with balloons and devices. So it's certainly feasible, but it has its own limitation, not only in terms of devices, but pushability. How do you cross the lesion? Typically, wire and catheter techniques are all what is required. You have your sheath, you have your support catheter. Our workhorse seems to be the 035 floppy glide wire and the SFA and popliteal. You can also use 018 platforms. Once you start getting below the knee, 014 platforms, and they come in different shapes and forms. Some of them have floppy tips, some of them are more stiff, and it depends on whether you're dealing with a tibial occlusion or a stenosis. There are some crossing devices that can be used. They are not our workhorse, but they can come in handy in a situation where you cannot cross with a wire and catheter techniques. If you end up in a subintimal plane with your wire, there are re-entry devices that you can use, such as the Outback device or the anterior re-entry system. Now, the retrograde approach is something that has been more commonly utilized nowadays in those patients who have failed an integrated revascularization. They seem to be quite feasible and safe, and have been part of, I would say, routine practice in the high-risk patient who cannot be revascularized with conventional ways. So what are some of the indications if you have a flush SFA or tibial occlusion that you cannot cross with conventional techniques? If you have a distal popliteal occlusion that extends into the orifice of the tibial vessel, sometimes it's not easy to get back from the up and over approach. And of course, those are patients who have failed an anti-grade recanalization typically and cannot get a bypass for different reasons. So this is such a case, old woman who has a popliteal stent that seems to be occluded. There's a blind segment of popliteal. There's a single perineal runoff. We tried to recanalize that. She also has a tibioperineal stent. I don't know if you can see that. We tried to get across that, and we ended up in a subintimal plane behind the stent. You can see that with the quick cross catheter behind the tibioperineal stent. So we couldn't cross, so we brought her back, and then we stuck the perineal right there at the ankle using fluoroscopic guidance. So this is the wire coming from the bottom. It went through the tibioperineal stent without any problems. And then we directed a quick cross catheter into that blind segment of popliteal and then up through the femoral sheath and then ballooned it. She had toe gangrene, ended up with a toe amputation, and then was able to heal that with that single perineal runoff. So what are the treatment options? What can you offer someone in terms of devices and techniques? Angioplasty seems to be the mainstay. And it comes in different shapes and forms. And now drug-eluting balloons are certainly adding to the mix. Stenting seems to be often required, perhaps in the SFA and popliteal distribution. Above the inguinal ligament, I mentioned that you're often going to use balloon expandable stents. And atherectomy can be useful in the infrainguinal distribution, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a few slides. So there are multiple options, and perhaps this tells you that none of them is perfect, right? If you have many ways to treat the same problem, you have to, I guess, pick and choose what your practice is and what you think works best, because none of them seems to offer significant advantages compared to the other. So angioplasty alone does not really offer a very good patency rate unless you use a drug-eluting balloon. And oftentimes you're going to have to stent after that. Self-expanding stents are typically used in the FemPop distribution. They seem to work well, especially with the newer generation stents such as the Supera stent. Balloon expandable stents, as I mentioned, are typically reserved above the inguinal ligament. This is such a case of an iliac occlusion. We used a balloon expandable stent in that situation, trying to land it very accurately at the orifice of that left common iliac. You could potentially have used a self-expanding stent there, but this is much easier to accurately position, and in very calcific lesions, this offers you somewhat more of a radial force whenever you blow it up with a balloon. Again, below the knee or infraingual intervention in the popliteal, this is just a bare metal stent. These seem to be the preferred stents in the infraingual distribution. Different ways to perform atherectomy, excisional, rotational, or laser atherectomy. So debulking the plaque may have some advantages and disadvantages. This is a case of excisional atherectomy. It seems to work well in no stent zones, areas that you really don't necessarily want to stent. Maybe the common femoral, maybe the orifice of the SFA, maybe the behind the knee popliteal. This is a focal lesion that was treated. Excisional atherectomy can be a standalone type of intervention. This is the kind of stuff that you remove. Rotational atherectomy also works, but you get micro debris that end up in the microcirculation. That may be an issue in diabetic patients with compromised microcirculation, but typically they're well tolerated. Laser atherectomy typically requires angioplasty, so it is rarely a standalone therapy, and now you can use it for in-stent restenosis. This is such a case of a below knee laser atherectomy with balloon angioplasty. The outcomes of atherectomy seems to be, I guess, comparable, not so much of an advantage compared to other techniques in terms of patency and limb salvage. So whether you decide to use atherectomy or not, you have to be comfortable with it and be aware that it may add some cost to the procedure and time, and the benefit compared to other modalities may or may not be there depending on the segment that you're treating and whether you want to avoid putting a stent or not. Just a couple of words on endograft placement. So covered stents can be used in the infraingulin distribution. They seem to do well. They are typically also very useful in patients who have recurrent disease and in-stent stenosis. So that is one modality, I think, that works fairly well in those patients. We keep developing in-stent stenosis. You can cover it with a heparin-bonded Viabond, and the durability of those and the patency seems to be quite respectable. This is such a case. Looks like any stent, pretty much. You have to be careful here, having a good runoff, because the patency of the Viabond stent seems to be affected by your runoff. So if you have a single vessel runoff, it may not work as well as if you had more than two vessel runoff. So bare stent lesion data, the patency continues to be limited, even with the Zilver PTX stent and drug-eluting stents. So there's still a lot of work to be done there. What I didn't put on the slide is the Supera stent patency, which seems to be much improved over what we've seen so far, especially in the popliteal distribution. So the one thing I want to tell you is that you're always going to have patients who have recurrent disease every 3 to 6 months, and then they're going to come back, and then you're going to say, okay, I'm going to angioplasty it or balloon it just once more. And then they come back 6 to 8 months later, and then they have, again, recurrence. So you can keep doing it, and nothing is going to happen, I mean, I guess, like you're changing the oil on your car or whatever. But just remember that there might be other options. So if you have your surgeons, after all, and if you have someone who might be a good candidate for a bypass, you might just have to decide to bite the bullet and change what you're doing, as opposed to continuing to doing the same endovascular intervention over and over again. So some promising technologies, you all know that drug-eluting technologies are now available to us, such as the Zilver PTX stents and the drug-eluting balloon, the Impact and the Lutonix balloon are now available. So the data seems to be pretty good in terms of improving patency at 1 year. I've mentioned the Supera stent, which seems to be quite more durable than the other bare metal stents, and now it has an SFA integration. Other devices that may be coming to us in the future, such as the Tigris stent, the heparin-bonded balloon expandable stent, which is for the iliac, and the trial, the enrollment has just been completed, actually a few days ago, and the bullfrog catheter, which injects steroids in the subintimal plane, it's still also in trial. And this also might increase the durability of endovascular intervention by minimizing future intimal hyperplasia. I think this was my last slide. Well, in summary, there are numerous endovascular options that are available. You have to, as I've mentioned over the past few slides, look at indications, location, the expected durability, the clinical presentation, the age of the patient, the cost, which has become certainly more visible and important nowadays whenever you're deciding how to treat a given patient. Thank you very much.